Hey guys, welcome to this video. In this video, I'm going to cover the differences between high availability and fault tolerance and how we can enable high availability on AWS. So high availability refers to ensuring that we have minimal service interruption for our applications or services. So whatever we're running on AWS, we want to make sure that it's available for use as much of the time as possible. So therefore, we need to design with no single point of failure. We can assume that things are going to fail even on AWS. Therefore, we have to make sure we build in redundancy. With high availability, we measure it in terms of the uptime. So, and it's a percentage number. So we've got 99.99% here. That means 99.99% of the time, the application should be available. We can use synchronous or asynchronous replication here. So with synchronous replication, when one system replicates data to another, it waits for a confirmation to come back to say that the data has been successfully received and written. With asynchronous, there's no sort of wait for that data to come back to confirm that the system has received and written the data. So asynchronous is a little bit faster, but it can result in data loss if there's a failure during that time frame. With high availability, it's typically a lower cost compared to fault tolerance. In terms of services that we can use, we've got elastic load balancing for distributing incoming connections to different targets, and we can spread those targets across multiple availability zones. We've got auto scaling, which makes sure that there's enough targets available, and if one fails, it replaces it. And then we've got Route 53, which is a DNS service, and it can be used to respond to queries for the IP address of the application in various different ways, either in a load balancing way, or it can also be a sort of failover manner as well for disaster recovery. Now, in this lesson, we'll look into auto scaling and load balancing in much more detail. So on the other hand, we've got fault tolerance. Here, you're looking for no service interruption whatsoever, and therefore you need specialized hardware that provides instantaneous failover. There should be no downtime at all with fault tolerance, even if one or more components fail in a system. Synchronous replication is the only fault tolerant replication mechanism, because with asynchronous, it could potentially lose data. And with fault tolerance, you want to ensure that there is zero data loss. There's definitely a higher cost here compared to high availability. A few examples are fault tolerant network interface cards, disk mirroring RAID 1, and synchronous DB replication. We'll have a look at some of these in a moment. And then you've got redundant power, of course. So every server should have redundant power supplies, and your data center should have redundant power sources as well. So let's have a look at fault tolerance. Here we've got a computer system that has a CPU, RAM, hard disk drive, and a network interface card. Now, if that network interface card fails, we've lost the network. If we lose a hard disk drive, we've lost the whole system. It won't work anymore. So here, there is no built-in redundancy. So what we want to do instead is we can implement a second hard drive. And this is where we might use RAID 1, which is disk mirroring. So that's a technology that mirrors the writes. In other words, every time a write is made to the disk, it goes to both disks at the same time, so they're exact copies of each other. And there's a specialized hardware adapter that will instantly fail over if one of those disks fails. Then we've got a second network interface card as well. So now if one network interface card goes down or one hard drive, no problem. We have fault tolerance because we have redundant components in the system. Now on AWS, fault tolerance is taken care of by AWS for the most part. You can implement RAID 1, but you don't really need to because there's a lot of durability in Amazon EBS, the Elastic Block Store. Things like network interface cards. Again, they build in the redundancy. You can add additional NICs into your instances, ENIs. You can attach them to your instance. So you can add that level of fault tolerance to your systems. But a lot of the fault tolerant components, things like the power supplies, of course, in the servers, the redundant power sources for the data center, the redundant networking components in the underlying infrastructure layer, AWS takes care of all of that. Now, what we can do is we can enable high availability on top of those fault-tolerant components of the underlying infrastructure. Let's have a look now at how we can implement high availability on top of that fault tolerant infrastructure that AWS provides. So here we have a load balancer, and you can see that some users have connected to that load balancer and they've been distributed to multiple web servers across multiple availability zones. Of course, each availability zone is essentially a separate data center. Can be more than one data center, but they are definitely separate data centers from each other. And they all have their own redundant power sources and redundant networking. And they're physically different buildings as well. So now we have lots of redundancy here. We've got several web servers across those two AZs. The connections have come in, they've been distributed nicely. Of course, if we had thousands of people connecting, they would just be load balanced across this infrastructure. Now, what if web server 2 fails here? If it fails, of course, the connection is broken, but now that user is redirected to web server 4. So no problem at all. There is a little bit of service interruption, but not too much. Now what's going to happen is AWS auto scaling is going to replace that web server. So now we've got the amount of web servers that we want back again. And of course, auto scaling can automatically ensure that there's always enough to service whatever the load is for the application at that point in time. Now, what if an entire AZ fails? Here we've gone down to one AZ. Well, that's okay, we've still got two web servers. We can launch more if we need more capacity. But even in the event of an entire availability zone failing, we still have access to our application. And now we can see those connections being redirected to web server 1 and web server 5 here. Lastly, I just want to cover the differences between durability and availability. You'll see these terms referenced a lot in terms of data storage. So durability is protection against data loss and data corruption. And S3 offers 11 nines of durability. So what does that mean? Well, you can see there it's 99 point and then 9 more nines. So if you store 10 million objects in S3, you can expect to lose one every 10,000 years. That's what that level of durability means. It means the chance of your data being lost is extremely low. So you're less worried about data loss and data corruption. Availability is different. So availability is a measurement of the amount of time the data is available to access. Okay, so your data might not be lost, but you can't access it. So it's expressed as a percent of time per year. So now we've got 99.99%. So much the same as what we were looking at before with high availability and fault tolerance. We're looking here at the ability to access our data. How much of the time can we actually access it? Many services on AWS have very high durability. And in some cases like S3 and EFS, you can choose the level of availability you want and you'll pay a bit more if you want higher availability.